Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining the session. I can see around one second. There are some 40 plus people have joined. I hope you are able to hear my voice. If there are any issues, please type in our chat window. As you all know, topic of the today's session is why should I be emotionally aware? And as you all know, the speaker of today's session is Mr. Suman Ghosh. He is an alumnus of our PGP program 1996. And let me give you a brief introduction of him. Yeah. Sir is Mr. Suman Ghosh holds an undergraduate degree from IIT Kharagpur and also, as you all know, an MBA from IIM Bangalore. And he's a co-founder of Inroads Leadership Development, and they work with middle to senior management and executive leadership through training, coaching, and consulting. He's a coach and trainer for the World Health Organization, part of the United Nations. He's also an author of best-selling book on emotional intelligence, namely From Command to Empathy, Using EQ in the Age of Disruption. He's also the author of Suman Insights. You can find it in a YouTube video blog on management and leadership, comprising bit-sized learning modules. And Suman is also qualified as a coach from Ericsson Coaching International and ICF accredited coach training program. Prior to this inroads, he has over two decades of corporate work experience in top multinational companies such as Cadbury's, Intel, Philips, and PricewaterhouseCoopers. His experience spans areas of practice building, program management, staff implementation, strategy, consulting, and logistics. And as you all know, I have mentioned in the mail, there are key takeaways are like why we need emotions at work and EQ and the creative economy and so on. Actually, I was sharing this webinar in the WhatsApp group and I got a response like this is the most need of the hour now, like people are looking forward to kind of these kind of a topics. So yeah, once again, thank you for joining. And I have also, my colleague Ankita has also joined with me and she's a like co-panelist. If any of you are facing any issues, please do type in a chat window and we'll be happy to help you. And a special welcome to Suman, sir. Over to you, sir. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Sushma. I am getting one request, annotation request. Should I approve or decline? I'm not very sure.
So annotations you can ignore, sir.
Okay. Great. Thank you so much, and thanks to all of you for joining. I'm going to talk about why should I be emotionally aware. This is a topic which is we keep doing this in different workshops in different organizations, and it's been getting a lot of interest. So let's see what we have. Okay. So if you just type in emotionally aware, what is emotionally aware? I just did that, by the way, before this session. It threw up about 100 million results. Okay, so it's all out there. The question is then, why do we really need to know this? I mean, probably you know it. If you don't know, you can always Google it. And I think that the key point there is something called the knowing-doing gap. A lot of us know a lot of things, but it doesn't mean necessarily we end up doing that. I think anybody who takes New Year resolutions knows exactly what I'm talking about, right? It stays, you have a lot of josh in January, and by February it kind of starts to fizzle out. And I think the gym guys know it very well. So the memberships also, they do it in a way that you sign up for a whole year, and there's a lot of people initially, but it fizzles out. Why does that happen? Could be for a couple of reasons. One is that knowing does not mean I understand, right? At the same time, if I understand, I may not be convinced. Even if I'm convinced, I may not be committed. So there is quite a bit of gap between the knowing and doing where things can fall off. Simon Sinek, I'm sure many of you would be knowing about him and follow him. He wrote this brilliant book called Start With Why. And while he talks about the why from a corporate perspective, he says, why is the purpose? And there's a lot of research right now about the purpose of organizations. And he calls it the golden circle, which is the why in the middle and the how and the what. But I think this applies to even when it comes to our individual selves, right? So the how part of being emotionally aware of all of that, those things is the easy part. But unless we are convinced on the why part, if the change is not going to happen, convinced and also committed. Okay. So let me start with a very simplistic picture. So we all have a head and a heart, right? So if one side is the rational, the other side is the emotional. If one side is thought, the other side is feelings. If one side is IQ, other side is a lot to do with the EQ. Even though the last one is not technically right in the sense EQ is not only about the heart, but it's a combination of the head and heart. But yeah, at a high level, it's basically the emotions come, you know, from the heart side, not from the head side. Okay. Let's do a quick poll here, and I'm hoping that this works well. Let me just try it. Okay, maybe I'll need to stop sharing. Okay. Hopefully, you should be able to see the poll in front of you. And if you can just answer the question. Okay, so we are almost done. I'll just close the poll in about 30 seconds. If you can just fill that up quickly. We have 83 people, out of which about 19 are yet to respond. Okay, so let me close the poll. We have 10 seconds left. Okay, so I'm not so sure if you can see the responses, but essentially what it is 23 have said rational, 48 people have said emotional, and 15 people have not responded. Okay, so let me go back to my slide deck again. So it's interesting, you know, a lot of you, majority of you feel that it's emotional. Right, and that is not rational. When I show this in the classrooms, I get a lot of responses saying that it depends, and that's deliberately why I did not put that as a question. And often my counter question would be, so you must be an MBA, and invariably they would say yes, because as business schools, you know, everything depends. But I wanted you to take a call. And it's interesting what has come up here, okay, and we'll get back to this. So let's stay with that. Let's ask a very fundamental question. Do we need emotions at work? Traditionally, if you look at management, if you look at leadership, emotions had very little role at work, right? It was more about being rational. Even today, when somebody gets emotional at work, what's the first thing you tell them? Hey, don't get, think rationally. Hey, don't get emotional. It's almost as if the emotions have got a bad name. Right, it's always about being rational, and we don't want to deal with emotions. Okay. Now, all that was fine, you know, in the industrial economy. And what has happened is the entire management science has evolved, you know, has evolved with the industrial economy. Right, if you look at Frederick Taylor and all those concepts that have come, essentially come from industrial economy. Now, this is a very interesting model which Gary Hamel actually talks about in his book, and he calls it the hierarchy of employee trades. He says essentially there are three types of economies. There is an industrial economy, and then what happened is the knowledge economy came on top of that, and then now we are having a creative economy. And on the left side, you see the trades which are essentially for these economies. Right? So for the industrial economy, it was more about obedience. It was more about diligence. When the knowledge economy came, one more layer got added. It was about intellect. But essentially, there was still like commodities, you know. And you know, and it's not that all this is, you know, happening in some different part of the world. I mean, I'm in Bangalore. If I look around in Bangalore, you have a lot of these, you know, industrial complexes, industrial places like Peenya, which is really about industrial economy, right? Small factories running. Then you have these huge, you know, IT offices, IT parks, which is about knowledge economy. And then there's a whole bunch of startups which are really working on the creative economy. Now, what is interesting is obedience, diligence, intellect is absolutely required, which is more IQ based. But when you get into the creative economy, what is required is going to be initiative, creativity, and passion. And that's where the challenge comes, right? So, and that's where the emotions come in. Because, you know, you can demand obedience, okay, but you cannot demand creativity. I cannot say, hey, you know what? Starting next Monday, please bring passion to work. It somehow doesn't work that way, right? Because it's an emotion we are talking about. It needs to come from within. You know, creativity, passion, all that needs to happen through an enabling atmosphere, right? It cannot happen by command and control. And that is one of the reasons why emotions are playing a bigger and bigger role. And it does not matter which industry you're in, right? When we, if I take a poll, even if you may be working in a manufacturing company, which you think is fairly industrial, but the point is the market out there is so volatile, it's a VUCA economy. You, without realizing, you're probably already in the creative economy. The other thing, you know, if you look at, and you know, we're talking about emotional intelligence because it's all about emotions. And in the World Bank, the World Economic Forum has this list that they come up with every 5 years, and they list the top 10 skills. And in 2015, you see that list on the right. In 2020, they have included emotional intelligence, which is point number 6. Okay, so there is a worldwide, there is a realization that getting emotions, being emotionally intelligent as leaders, as managers is absolutely critical. Let me pause here and tell you a story that happened to me. And this was actually quite an inflection point in my career. So I passed out of IMB in 1996, and thereafter I've been in strategy consulting. I used to do technology consulting with Pricewaterhouse. Did that for many years, and then I was getting into a senior position in a company, and for that, the company told me to go and get an assessment done. So I went to, they told me a name of another company, I went there. It was a pretty grueling exercise, it was a whole day exercise. The idea was at the end of it, they would give a report as to whether I would fit culturally with the organization. And among the many things that were there, one was a case study, which I had to, you know, read up and then present in a role play. And just like you're seeing here, I was on one side and the other gentleman who was assessing me was on the other side. I read the whole case study and I was ready to do the role play. And essentially what it was is it gave a scenario, and then at the end of it, I was to, let's say there were two options, let's call that A and B. I was supposed to convince him of going with option B, which I thought was a better option. So all that happened, and the end of it, when I was done, he asked me, so are you done? Are you good? I said, yeah. He thought for a while. He said, Suman, unfortunately, I'll not go with what you said. And it came as a big shock to me. So I was like really perplexed. And I said, what happened? Was my analysis wrong? He said, your analysis was spot on. Okay, obviously, all that business school training helped a lot. Right? Then I was even more perplexed. I said, then what is the problem? He said, I did not see any emotions or much emotions. And I remember going back that day and then thinking that, you know, what happened to this, all this analytical mind that I was so proud of? what are you talking about? This is a new word to me. You know, how does emotions come into the picture? Okay. And that got me into this entire world of, you know, emotional intelligence that started my journey. And now actually I personally am very involved in this. As Sushma mentioned, I wrote a book. Anyway, that's a different story. But I want to narrate this story that often, you know, growing up, we think it's more rational. We are very analytical, but we forget the emotional side. Now, why is it important? Let's look at that. Okay. So very quickly, what is emotional intelligence? At a very fundamental level, it's nothing but the ability to identify, manage, and express emotions. Okay. At the simplistic level, the difference with IQ is that IQ is about the self, EQ is always about two people. So if I have high EQ and if I'm talking to you, it's the ability for me to identify my emotions, manage my emotions and express it. But at the same time, you know, ability to identify your emotions, not manage but maybe influence your emotions and create an environment where you're also able to express your emotions. So that's what EQ really is. Now, many of you have, and EQ has become a very big topic, and there is a lot of stuff being written, and it's become a fairly wide gamut of things, and you know, there are a lot of frameworks. But the one which I like, and many of you would have seen this already, is really this one, which is about a 2x2 quadrant, okay? Which is on the y-axis you have the knowledge and the management. Remember we talked about the knowing-doing gap? So top part is knowing, the bottom part is doing. And on the x-axis, you have the self and the others. Okay? So let's see how that builds. So if you have knowledge of self, that's really about self-awareness. Once we have that, it's about self-management or self-regulation. Once we are done with the left two, that's really about self-mastery. You know, we really got ourselves to a level where we fully understand ourselves and manage ourselves. Goes to the essence of leadership. But leadership is not about just me, but it's also about managing other people. And that's the right side comes in. Knowledge of others, social awareness, also called empathy. Okay, and I'm sure you've heard this word very often now, empathy. And finally, it's about relationship management. What I really like about this model is that each builds on the other. Okay, so it starts with self-awareness, then goes to self-regulation, because without awareness, you cannot manage it. Only when you do that can you be empathetic to other people. And then when we do all of that, we get into relationship management. So while let's get into each of these boxes in a little bit of detail to understand what we're talking about. But we'll go backwards, right? Because ultimately it's about relationship management. So let's see what is relationship management. So advanced social skills are a cumulative effect of the other dimensions of EQ. And many of you from business schools if you are working in corporates, you see these words very often in your day-to-day lingo, right? Influencing, inspirational leadership, conflict, teamwork, change catalyst, all of this stuff. But all of that essentially boils down to relationship management. It's essentially how do you manage, how do you work with people, right? To me, this is leadership. So in a sense, relationship management is really all about leadership. Now, let's watch a short video, and this goes back to, you know, that poll that we did in terms of are our decisions rational, or your decisions rational or emotional. Let me play this. I hope you're able to hear it.
Most of our decisions, whether we like it or not, most of our actions, most of our behavior, most of our experiences, are constantly being shaped as the instinctual level. I would argue that about 90 to 95% of our decisions, even important decisions, you might think that you're being rational, but keep in mind that if you pit the rational brain against the emotional brain, in general, it is the emotional brain that's going to win out. In fact, I have this quote out there which says that the rational brain is not good at being rational. What it is good at is simply rationalize what the emotional brain has already designed to do, and therefore behooves us to understand the workings of the instinctual emotional brain. Neuromodulators.
I hope you were able to catch that, but anyway, if you didn't, not a problem. I'll quickly summarize it here. By the way, I've also given the link, so if you have time, you can go and watch this video. It's from Baba Shiv, who's a well-known professor of decision-making from Stanford University. And I don't know if you caught that, he mentions that if you pit one against the other, the emotional brain wins out. And then he goes on to say something very interesting. He says, the rational brain is good at rationalizing what the emotional brain has already decided. Okay? And I know this almost sounds counterintuitive. When I show this to to leaders, to very senior people, I often get a pushback. And probably goes back to this thing of we take pride in saying we are very rational, that we are not emotional. But this is what it is. I mean, the emotional brain is showing that somebody wrote the Thinking Fast and Slow. Yeah, I will come to that. And this has huge implications to us as leaders, right? We may be thinking that we are being rational, but essentially what we are doing is that we are rationalizing what the emotional brain has already decided. Now, there is another story which is kind of building on that, which I also thought was very interesting. So there's this neuroscientist by the name Antonio Damasio wrote this book called Descartes' Error. Now, he was actually working with patients who had damage in the part of the brain which controlled emotions. Okay. Now, these people were absolutely fine because their rational side was completely intact. So if you talk to them, they were like normal people. There was no way you could tell that their emotional side had got impacted. But then he found something very interesting. Smallest of decisions, they were having trouble taking. Like smallest of decisions, even in terms of what to eat and what to wear. If you ask them, they would give you a perfectly logical response. If you ask them, would you like to have fish or chicken? They would tell you, the benefits of each. Okay, but if you told them to pick, so what do you like to eat now? They would have trouble actually telling you. And the same thing happened across all these kind of patients. And then it dawned on him that essentially, and this is what he summarizes that is as, he says the rational drives us to options, but emotions move us to action. What was happening in those brains is that, decision making, if you look at the logical steps, is about building the options, analyzing the options, and then finally picking an option. The first two is a rational process, but picking the option is really an emotional process. Okay, and that is why those people were having challenges in kind of picking the options. So we may be thinking we are being rational. All we are being rational about is analyzing. But finally, the emotional brain goes and picks what it wants to. And the rational brain only rationalizes what that emotional brain has picked. Now, why am I dwelling on this? Because imagine the implication it has on leaders. What is a leader's job, right? Our leader's job is to move people to action. It is not about doing that work ourselves. Right? That's the transition that happens from an individual contributor to a manager. And then really about galvanizing people into action. And the only way you can do it through emotions. Logic doesn't move people, emotions do. If there is one thing I would like to take away from this entire webinar, it's this, that emotions move people to action. And that is the reason why we need to place so much emphasis on emotions. Okay. Now, having looked at the fourth quadrant, let's come back to the third quadrant, which is empathy. And remember, I said each one builds on the other. Now, how is empathy important? Without empathy, we cannot be really building relationships. Okay. So what is empathy? Empathy is the ability to identify, understand, and feel another situation, concerns, and motives. So there's really two aspects to empathy. One is what we call the cognitive empathy and the affective empathy. So cognitive is about the thinking parts, it's cognition. I think what you think, okay? And the affective empathy is I can feel what you feel. And I'm sure you've had, situations or people in your work life, like bosses, who kind of had a sixth sense. You walk into the room and they can tell you what you're feeling or what you're thinking. They'll tell you, okay, I know what you're thinking. That's essentially cognitive empathy. Okay? And he can also feel what you're feeling. That's affective empathy. A person expresses sympathy but shares empathy. Okay? And we are often sympathetic, but empathy is something that we need to build. Empathy is deeper. It forges more meaningful connections between individuals and between a leader and his team members. Okay. Now, this is a cartoon which I thought is quite interesting. I'll give you a few seconds to read it. Yeah. And I think this, to me, very well summarizes what happens at our workplace. You know, a lot of these things happen, but all he had to say was it didn't come up. So nothing about the person ever comes up when we're talking to a person because it's entirely transactional, right? And this is the reason why empathy doesn't get built, right? And right now there's a lot of talk because the situation has only got worse because now we are remote, okay? It just doesn't come up because typically what used to happen is in a call, we would pick up the phone and get into transactions, and that's what's happening today. So even those little interactions that we were having in the corridor, or we were having in the canteen, where we were talking of non-work stuff, is not happening today, right? So empathy is actually even reducing further thanks to you know, the fact that we are working remotely. And companies are trying to grapple with it. So there's a lot of things people are looking at. There's some a concept of a virtual water cooler that companies are experimenting with. So give it that a little bit of time, you know. So one quick, you know, idea could be in a remote thing, when we pick up the phone, let's ask, how are you? It's very powerful, right? How are you doing? What is the typical question that we first ask nowadays, by the way? Hey, can you hear me? Or can you see me? So those things have become the most common thing, right? So next time, let's not say, can you hear me? But let's say, how are you? Okay? Very powerful. So that really goes to empathy. And we can, you know, we won't be able to spend time, but, you know, it's important to understand how to build empathy because that's where the emotional connect builds. Now, here also, there is a neuroscience behind this. The neuroscience is called the mirror neurons. Now, essentially, you know, everything in our brain is through neurons, and we have some 100 billion neurons in the brain. What they discovered that a part of this, a subset of these neurons are called mirror neurons, which fire when the same, when you see the other person, when you see the same action being performed on another person. And this was fascinating to neuroscientists. Okay? And that is really what mirror neurons is all about. Okay? Now, what that really means, that emotions are contagious. So picture this, you've gone into work on a Monday morning, okay, and let's say at 10 o'clock you have the staff meeting every Monday morning, and your colleagues have all come in into the room, and it's, you know, people are smiling and they're, you know, greeting each other and they're talking about how their weekend went, very nice atmosphere, right? Suddenly the boss walks in, looking tense, looking down, okay. Instantly, in an instant, he just kind of sucks the energy out of the room like that, right? And everybody is tense. Right? Now imagine this has happened in a split second. Not a word has been spoken. But essentially what has happened is because emotions are contagious, our mirror neurons are firing inside us. And it will mirror what you're seeing. Okay? Now imagine the impact a leader has on the people. Even before a word has been spoken, this happens in milliseconds. And it's important as leaders for us to understand that emotions are contagious. And that is why we need to manage our emotions. Okay? Leaders have a tremendous amount of impact on the people just based on how they are behaving. Okay? Now, the question is, how do we bring back empathy? See, the question is not framed as how do we build empathy, because we are born with empathy. For many of you might know this, that, you know, when if you take a child, or even a very small, maybe a newborn child, and you place him next to another child who's crying, the child starts crying. And essentially what neuroscientists are saying is that this is happening because of mirror neurons. Nothing, this is happening before a child has even learned communication. Okay? But because our mirror neurons are at play, we feel what the other person is feeling. That's inborn, right? That's how we are made. Okay? So really it's about how do you bring back empathy. And of course, there are many ways. We will not be able to get into the solutioning part. But one thing I'd like to leave you with is what is called empathetic listening. You know, listening to understand as opposed to listening to respond. And if this is, you know, when it comes to listening, I think this is a tremendous paradigm shift, right? So see, Stephen Covey in his book, in The 7 Habits, he talks about this. And he says, most people do not listen with the intent to understand. They listen with the intent to reply. So maybe you can take a pause and think, next time when you're listening to somebody, are you really listening with the intent to understand or to reply? I often also get this question that, hey, you're telling me to be empathetic, but doesn't that make me look weak, right? And I come back to this point and saying, look, Empathy means you understand. It does not mean you agree. And there is a big difference there. I can be empathetic. I can listen to you, which also means that your point of view may be completely opposite of what I feel. But let me at least understand where you're coming from. I don't have to agree with you. Okay? So I think that's a very powerful thing, which is really about empathetic listening. And there are other ways of building empathy, which could also be around feedback. Okay? So there is a beautiful quote from Theodore Roosevelt. He said, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Right? So remember, one is the cognition part and one is the emotional part. And don't we do this, right? Doesn't this happen with people like us, with us, right? When our agents, let's say an agent calls you, don't you think this is true? End of the day, you're also trying to assess, maybe at a subconscious level, does this person really care about my well-being? Only then we start to care. Okay, so now if you think about it, we've looked at the right two boxes, which is really about managing others, which is relationship empathy. Now, that will bring us to do all of that, we need to have self-regulation. Okay? Now, what is self-regulation? Self-regulation is, to put it very simply, it's really about moving from compulsion to choice. The moment we are doing something not from compulsion, but with a choice that's given to us and we are picking that, that's when we are really doing self-regulation. People who have high self-regulation, they feel bad moods and emotional impulses just as everyone else, but they're able to control them better. It's important to understand this difference. It's not we are trying to avoid or suppress or deny an emotion. You know, we often go to the workplace kind of trying to suppress the emotion, right? We try to be completely rational. Right? But it's not about suppression. Remember, you need to bring emotions to work because that's what moves people. Okay? But it's really not about avoiding or suppressing. Now, how does that help? It helps to suspend judgment, right? Thinking before acting, comfort with ambiguity, which is tremendously required today in our VUCA world. And the last part, which is again very interesting, which Daniel Goleman says, is integrity, he says, is part of self-regulation. And he makes a very interesting case. He's saying, look, nobody gets into work with the intent to create a fraud, right? But what happens is something presents itself, which is kind of a border as to what he should do and maybe he should avoid. And because we don't have self-regulation, we end up doing that. And then something slightly bigger happens, and bigger happens, and before you know it, it becomes very large. I don't know if how many of you remember what Ramalinga Raju said in his statement, you know, when the entire Satyam thing imploded. He had made a statement. He said, it was like riding a tiger, not knowing when to get off without getting eaten. And I think what he was talking was that. So, you know, it was essentially getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And at some point, you're riding a tiger and then you can't get off it. So integrity also actually is about self-regulation. Oh, by the way, many of you may be wondering what this picture has got to do with self-regulation. So here's a small story. So this man was riding in his horse. And, you know, a passerby asked him, where are you going? And he looked at the passerby and said, I don't know, ask the horse. But the point is, it's a nice metaphor where the horse is like an emotion, right? You know, you need the horse because the horse is very powerful. It can take you places. But it's great when the horse doesn't decide where to go, you decide. So, you know, when we are wanting to manage our emotions, we need to bring the emotions, we need to get the horse along, don't leave the horse somewhere else. Get the horse, but you take the decisions, okay? And I personally find this metaphor very powerful, that you maintain, which also means you have some kind of a distance between the rider and the horse. There's some kind of difference between your thought process and your emotion. That's when, you know, you're able to look at your own emotions as opposed to getting washed away by it. And that brings us to the concept of mindfulness, and we'll talk about that. Now, again, how it is linked, there's a beautiful quote says, the quieter you become, the more you can hear. So what does this mean? The quieter you become, which is about self-regulation, the more you can hear, which is about empathy. Okay? So you see how those two boxes are also linked. You know, we often live in our heads. Many of us live in our heads. We have 20,000 things going on in our heads. If I do that, you know, I'm constantly in my head, how am I being present when I'm with somebody else? As a leader, when I'm talking to somebody, am I really being present, not just physically, but emotionally and mentally? And that cannot happen if I have clarity of thought and I have a clear mind. Okay? Again, easier said than done, extremely, extremely difficult. Okay? But we need to, that's why self-regulation is a building block which builds empathy. And of course, hot buttons, right? Discovering which behavior, situations, and people trigger your hot buttons will allow you to take more responsibility. Now, hot buttons is what? It's nothing but what lights your fuse, right? And I'm sure all of us have our hot buttons, right? So hot buttons is, you know, I'm sure you understand what this is, right? So what lights your fuse? You know, so if you ask in a very simple way, aapka fuse udta hai kya? Haan, udta to hai. So why? When does it happen, right? So maybe we'll pause here and let's look at some, maybe you can put it in your chat. So tell me what lights your fuse? What is your hot button? I'll tell you one of mine. For instance, I have a, you know, my hot button is somebody cuts me in, or let's say I'm driving and somebody suddenly cuts me in, and then there is road rage. And I've been trying to control that for years. But you know what? It's tough. Yeah. And this is, again, but it's important to start being aware of our hot button. It's also about awareness, and then we can start managing that. Okay? So let's hear from some of you what your hot buttons are. Okay, somebody says lies. Okay, Bhavna says lies. Okay, someone interrupts you in between. Yeah, excellent. See, it doesn't take much, right? Cheating, definitely. What else? Underestimates. Okay, disrespect. Yeah, absolutely. When people walk and talk is different. Yeah, exactly. You know, you don't know what they're going to say and what they're going to do later. Ask questions. My hot one, when someone starts using their, start using their phones, good one. Chahana, you know, this is true for a lot of people, right? When suddenly somebody's on the phone, you're talking and somebody, the phone rings and he picks it up. That could be a hot button. People do not respect others' space. Playing with my emotions, okay. Somebody uses vulgar language. Yeah, absolutely. That's a complete no-no for some of us. Okay. My hot button, when will you marry? Okay. So Aditya, I know, I'm not going to ask you that question now. Okay. Trust is my hot button. Okay. When someone trying to dominate. Amazing, amazing. See, just look. And you know, for some of you who've written stuff here, just look at what the others have written. And I'm sure you'll see that a lot of them are common with you. Isn't it? So the point is, we all have our hot buttons. Okay, and this can actually, these are the times when a hot button gets pressed, we can lose touch with our emotions. And what did we say before? We said thanks to emotional contagion, it's important to manage our emotions. So while we want to manage it, it's the hot buttons which come into play, right? When someone is judgmental, somebody said honking, yeah. It can be something as simple as that. You know, somebody cutting you in a grocery line. Or somebody just honking behind you can actually trigger a hot button in people, right? And what is a hot button? It's not a rational process. I'll not get into the neuroscience of hot buttons, but I'll just touch upon it. Essentially, this is happening at a subconscious level, okay? And which is what makes it very scary. Great, thanks. So this is really helpful. Let me move on. So what creates this hot button? So it's something called a fight or flight. Okay? So you know, the way we are our brains are wired, when we look at something, the brain has to quickly decide whether it's a threat or it's a reward. And this has to be done, you know, very quickly. Because what happens is, if you look at evolution, if it was a threat and if you took time, that could be a big, maybe something dangerous to your life. So the brain had to quickly decide whether it was a threat. And based on that, if it thinks it's a threat, it will move away. If it's a reward, it will move towards. Unfortunately, we've not gone away. You know, there are three parts of the brain. I'll not get into that. But that reptilian brain, that most primitive brain, which controls with that fight or flight response, is still very much active in us. So all this higher order thinking that happens, which makes us different from other species in the neocortex, doesn't get activated once you are in a fight or flight. Let me ask you a question. Has it happened to you? And maybe you can just write in the chat, okay? And it's a very simple question. Has it ever happened to you that you've done something in the spur of the moment and really regretted it later and thinking, and maybe you were saying, what was I thinking? Yeah? If you've gone through that situation, maybe you can just put it in a chat. Okay. Chitra says often, yes, always, many times. See? Now what's happening? Always, yes, 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 oh my God. So many of you have written yes. And I think this is something, we, especially after having an argument, absolutely. And this happens to us often. You know, now I have controlled, I think, okay, yes. So what's happening, again, at a very simplistic level, the moment the fight or flight gets triggered, our rational brain stops thinking, okay, because the emotional brain takes over. And that is why when you say, what was I thinking? Actually, you were not thinking. Okay? And imagine that what that happens, what that can do to a leader. Let's say you're otherwise calm, but a hot button gets triggered and you kind of completely lash out on the other person, right? And essentially you're showing those emotions and that becomes, you know, prevalent in the organization. Over time, that becomes the culture of the organization, okay? So let's see how that thing, you know, manifests in certain ways. So one is make a first good impression, they say, right? And the good impression, the first impression comes from that initial assessment, whether it's a threat or a reward. So we tend to make snap judgments about situations, about people. That's why they say you don't get a second chance to make the first impression, okay? So that is also about a threat or reward. And of course, somebody typed earlier, he put in chat, is about thinking fast and slow. You're absolutely right. So this is linked to what Daniel Kahneman talks about in this wonderful book called Thinking Fast and Slow, where thinking slow is really the rational thing, where you're invoking the neocortex. The thinking fast is the instant response to snap judgments that we are making. Okay? So that's really about the fight or flight. So what do we do about it? Very briefly, you know, we have our body and our mind, but the point is the mind is always going all over the place. Okay? Now the mind is also called the monkey mind because our mind is, you know, there are 60,000 thoughts, they say, which comes to people's mind on a daily basis. Imagine the havoc that it creates, right? When you're in the morning meeting, you're thinking of the evening, the afternoon meeting. In the afternoon meeting, you're thinking of your dinner with your family or the restaurant that you're planning to go to. And in the restaurant, you're actually thinking of the next day's meeting, right? So again, this does not allow us to be present in the moment. Okay? So this is really how do you fix your mind? And that is the concept of mindfulness. Okay? So there are many definitions of mindfulness. The one which I like, which is the most simplistic, is when you're thinking and doing the same thing, that's being mindful. The moment those two are not aligned, you're not being mindful. Right? It can be as something as simple as mindful eating. Right? When you're eating, are you also watching something on your phone or talking to somebody on the phone? Then you're not being mindful because then you're focused on the eating. Okay? That's what mindfulness is. Now, without mindfulness, there is from a stimulus, you get a reaction. With mindfulness, from a stimulus, there's a pause and then there's a response. This is amazingly powerful. There's this book by Viktor Frankl. For many of you who may not be aware, Viktor Frankl was a Jew who got sent to the Nazi concentration camps, and he and his whole family, he was the sole survivor. His entire family perished. They were killed in cold blood in front of him, in front of his eyes. So nobody could have gone through more atrocity than what Viktor Frankl did. But over time, you know, he not only kind of managed it well, but he became an expert on that. And you know, even when he was within his cell, the German guards would come and take advice from him. And he wrote this phenomenal book called Man's Search for Meaning. And in there he says, between stimulus and response, there is a space. In that space is our power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. So it's not really about the stimulus, it's about our response. And those two need not be linked, as long as we are mindful. Similarly, recently I heard Bill Gates in one of the you know, the talks that he was doing, he made a statement, we are in the same storm but in different boats. He was talking about the lockdown, he was talking about the coronavirus thing. But think about it, it's essentially saying the same thing. The storm is the stimulus that we are going through, but we are in different boats because, you know, everybody's reaction is different. And I think, and that's where the pause comes in, that's what makes it so powerful. Now, this is all this when you are in a heightened state, but what happens in autopilot is at subconscious level. Now, how many of you remember doing simple things like brushing your teeth or tying your shoelace, right? Chances are you don't remember. It happens at an automatic level, right? And again, going to the brain science of it, what they've realized is the brain always is trying to conserve it's a load. I mean, trying to conserve its processing thing because it's too much load, too much to handle. So anything it finds repetitive actually stores in a different part of the brain called the basal ganglia, okay, like an algorithm. So all it needs is a trigger and you do that and the brain doesn't have to think. Okay? Now, the thing that is stored separately is also called a habit. So we are creatures of habit. What does this mean for us as leaders? Isn't that amazing? Right? So essentially what you're saying is this takes away from mindfulness. Somebody comes and talks to us and we give an automatic response because without realizing we are in the autopilot mode, that we are not taking a call. So we give what is called a standard response. Right? We are not able to calibrate based on the emotional state of the person on the other side. Okay? That takes away from being effective as a leader. Okay? And that is why we need to be mindful of our emotions at that state, because with every person we may have to calibrate our response. So we talked quite a bit about self-regulation, and all of this starts with self-awareness. Okay? So what is self-awareness? It's nothing but the ability to recognize and understand our moods, our emotions, our drives, and more importantly, what is the effect on others. You know, interestingly, we all feel we are self-aware, but what they're finding in research is that most people are not self-aware. And the people who feel that they're very self-aware are the ones who are actually least self-aware. How do others perceive them if they don't, you know, people who are high self-aware, they are able to understand better. I'll give you an example. Let's say you ask people, are you a good listener? And a lot of people will say, I am a good listener. But ask his team members whether he's a good listener. And the point is, if the team member says something which is totally contrary to that, it only shows that the leader is very low self-awareness. He's not able to perceive how others perceive him or her. Okay? That is what self-awareness is. In terms of, you know, its components, there are two major ones, which is emotional awareness, what drives us, what needs and emotions we have. Okay? And again, look at the word, it's about emotional awareness. It's what am I feeling? It's not what I'm thinking. Because again, most often we get a response in terms of what am I thinking? It's cognitive. But here, are we in touch with your emotions? Do you know what you're feeling right now? Are you in touch with that? That's very important. And the other is, of course, understand our strengths, limits, and priorities, which is the cognitive side, which gives us self-assessment. And how that helps is build self-confidence, more willing to learn. It gives us humility, ability to work on constructive criticism. Okay, so we essentially saw how those things were connected. I'd like to end with this slide, which is being heard and understood is one of the greatest desires of the human heart. Okay, this is what we all strive for. That is what we all crave for. And to do that, we need to have empathy. We need to build relationships. We need to have emotional connect. And for doing that, we need to manage our own emotions. And to do that, we need to be self-aware. Okay. So that brings me to the end. So essentially, just to quickly tell you what are the kind of other things that we would do typically in a workshop mode is, you know, build on each one of them. So let's say in relationship management, we look at something called active constructive responding. You know, interestingly, we have found that in relationships, especially with couples or with people who are very close, it's not about how we behave with each other when things are bad. It's about how you behave with each other when things are good. And there is something called active constructive responding framework, which is used by the US military to train its soldiers. Very, very powerful. How do you have courageous conversations? How do you have difficult conversations? You know, typically we all tend to avoid that. But when we have high self-regulation, the idea is not to avoid. Remember, we said it's not about avoiding. It's able to take the bull by the horns and have that and learn about how to manage courageous conversations. How do you influence? What are the four stages of learning? In terms of self-regulation, what are my hot buttons? Try to understand that in more detail. What are my team's hot buttons? We delve more into decision-making and how really it's driven by emotions. And that brings us to the concept of our unconscious biases. Then we delve more into mindfulness and autopilot. And how do you resolve that? We didn't have time to talk about, you know, how do you go about that? So this entire, what is called a stress response, and the opposite of that, the relaxation response. That can have many aspects. It could have meditation, mindful meditation, things like that. In terms of social awareness, the neuroscience of empathy, emotional contagion, what are the five levels of listening, right? How do you really build those listening skills of empathetic listening, listening to understand? Feedback skills, again, I think two things in leadership is to be able to start them having the mindset, the humility, the vulnerability to have feedback, to be able to give feedback and take feedback. And in terms of self-awareness, you know, our emotional awareness, to focus on strengths. So there's a concept of strength finder, right? How do you build habits? How does that differ from willpower? Self-reflection, how do we go about reflecting on, can you build that into some kind of habits in terms of self-reflection? How do we uncover our passion? A link to that is the best self-exercise, okay? That brings me to the end. Let's see how I'm doing with time. I think we still have a few minutes left. I'll be happy to take your questions. Sushma, maybe if there are questions, you could just read out. I'm also trying to see here.
So one thing is how to apply EQ in real life from Alok.
Yeah, so let me quickly address some of them. So how do you apply EQ in real life? Is that from Alok? Yeah. Yeah, so you know what, Alok? All that I talked about was really about implementing in real life. But as I said, it's very hard to do. It's that classical knowing doing gap. And this comes from years of practice. It can even take a lifetime. You know, remember I talked about the four stages of learning. So in our workshops, we get into that. And essentially, you know, the change doesn't happen overnight. It takes a huge amount of time. But what happens is you start seeing the change once you build in awareness and you build in mindfulness and you start reflecting. And then you realize on a day-to-day basis, where is it that you're going wrong? For instance, I'll give you a simple example. Let's say if your hot button is pressed, if you're not aware of it, nothing changes. You're not even aware. But if you are, then you know your hot button has got pressed, and there are ways and means of making sure that the same hot button doesn't trigger it the next time. Okay. How to strike the balance? Next question is how to strike the balance of maintaining empathy and having the work done. Again, let's not look at these two as two different things. Remember that one of the frameworks we had read in management was the 2x2 with, you know, high on task and high on people. And I don't think they need to pull at each other. They need to coexist. Okay? It's not that because I have empathy, I don't get the work done. Of course, you get the work done. When I'm talking empathy, I'm also talking about work itself. But can we do it in a way that the other person feels connected? And that's what empathy is all about. And there are tools and techniques of doing that. There are certain words that you'd like to avoid, right? For instance, the moment the person feels that they're being threatened, they will go to get into a fight or flight. So for instance, in a simple one, like for instance, the use of the word you as opposed to we, as opposed to I, can make it very powerful. Okay.
So there was one for that.
How do we deal
there
with
was one thing.
Bias? Vinita is asking. So Vinita, this is a topic in itself. I won't be able to get into this. But unconscious bias basically throws a lot of light on why our decision making is more emotional. And bias by definition is something you cannot eliminate. You can only be aware of it, right? So as we are aware of the bias, we can manage our decisions better. How do you control your emotions in leadership teams? Not really sure what you mean by that. Yeah, so some of the concepts we talked about would apply on a one-on-one, would apply in teams as well, right? And it's about managing those emotions. See, showing the emotions is not powerful. I'll give you know, emotions are very powerful, like that horse. See, even a negative emotion, let's say anger, can be an extremely powerful emotion, right? If I'm angry, you know, there's no reason I should suppress that. I should show it as long as I don't lose it. As long as the horse is not deciding where to go. As long as I decide what to do, but the message goes very loud and clear that I'm angry because of this. And that actually, you know, can be a big motivator for people as well. How to practice so that responding becomes a habit than reacting? Wow. Yeah, so that's where, as I said, this is a lifelong learning, you know. In fact, one question I always grapple with, and one of the things which I have got into my reflection exercises, am I practicing what I'm preaching, right? Believe me, I'm still on the journey. It's not like you'll ever get there, right? Do I have hot buttons? Absolutely. Do I lose it sometimes? Absolutely. Have I got better? Definitely. So it's a journey, it's not a destination. It's refreshing to see a corporate person telling the importance of EQ. It's unfortunately still considered a weakness. Absolutely, Asta, I fully agree with you. And for me, it's like a complete revelation. I started with that story and I realized that, you know, I used to take pride in being analytical. I was completely left brain. I did my IIT, I've done my IIM. Unfortunately, I've not learned any of these things in those institutes because we're still so focused on the cognitive side, right? Where do we talk of emotions in these schools, right? Where do we talk of strategy? Do we talk of culture, right? Those are the things which are more important. We talk of being rational. Where do we talk of emotions? I'm just hoping that, you know, this becomes more, and this more, what should I say, ingrained, not only in these schools, but in starting with schools and even in corporates. But I must say this, that there's a huge interest in corporates because people are realizing, end of the day, leadership is not about those techniques. It's really about managing ourselves.
So actually, there was one question before. I think you missed.
I hope I've been able to address. Thank you so much. Some of you have written very nice comments saying that you enjoyed it. So happy to hear that. Sushma, are you there?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me? Hello. Hello.
Okay, great session. Thank you for a great session. Thank you so much. I think we've still 2 minutes to go. I hope I've been able to address your questions. By the way, my details are all here, so feel free to reach out to me. Do check out our YouTube channel. I personally also do a small video blog on leadership, micro-sized, bite-sized learning. These are about 2-3 minutes, and you can use that for your people. They're like very quickly you can grab a, you can get a kind of a bit of information on a particular topic. Okay, so do reach out, do see, check out our YouTube channel, subscribe to it, and feel free to write to me on this, on the details that I've mentioned here. Okay? I'd love to engage with you. Thank you so much.
Hello, can you hear me, sir? Hello? Hello?
Okay, I'm not able to hear anything. So if there is something, maybe you can just type it here. Okay, so Sushma, I think she's having some issues with her audio. No problem. So I think there's a feedback form that she shared. Kindly fill that up. We'd love to hear from you in terms of what you thought about this session. And I look forward to connecting with you. Yeah, do reach out.